to talk today about typings.
My name is Eli Gur. I'm a serial entrepreneur, typically a VP R&D or a CTO or both of them. And as I mentioned yesterday, I'm also involved in a social company dealing with employment for religious Orthodox people in Israel called RavTech. Rav is a rabbi, and tech is obviously high tech. And we have a group of Python programmers, so if you're looking for some, you're most welcome to address me. As you see, I'm using Guido's presentation. It's planned for a longer time than 30 minutes, so I'll have to skip some of the parts. So what are we going to talk about? First, a little about the motivation and what it's all about. Then a little about the syntax, so you are familiar with it and hopefully would like to use it. If we'll have time, a little about the history of the relevant PEPs for this. And as it is mainly a 3.5 feature, although it exists also in Python 2 in a different version, I'll be talking about, but a little maybe conclusions, and then I hope we'll have some time for question and answers. So why do we need a type checker? A Python is, after all, a dynamic functions, no types, and everything is an object. We can do whatever we want. It seems like other languages do use type checkers, and they have strong. Some of them are strongly typed, and you have to. Everything has to have a type. You can't just have something untyped and just collect them. So one reason is to find the bugs earlier. If we have something that can identify an error that we are doing and we didn't notice, maybe using type checking, we can identify that earlier. And this becomes important as we scale up, as we have more programmers, more people, especially when we are going to maintenance and we think this is doing something and we're not sure, and sometimes the code doesn't explain itself good enough for us to understand what kind of object we're dealing with and what was the idea behind the function. And then annotations can help us. And in real world, in Python, Google, Dropbox, and actually other large teams already started using static analysis. PyCharm is analyzing your code, and sometimes, even if you don't use type hinting at all, it still can say, okay, you use something, and it should have been a string. It knows somehow, by smart analysis of the code, that some part of it, some variable, should have been a string, and you put an integer instead, and it says, wow, you have an error, it marks you the error. Obviously, type checker can help us during code writing. So what's the idea behind type hints? Most important is to help the type checker. As I said, we can do type checking even in Python without type hints, but we can do much better if we do have the type hints, especially when we use dynamic Python, and then sometimes it's very difficult to understand what we're doing, what the object is, and what we're doing with it, and whether or not it's okay to put a string where an integer is expected. Also, by doing type hints, we get more documentation, which is built in the code, so the code explains itself better. The better the IDE is, the easier our work with it, and we can speed up our development speed. I must say, as a VP R&D or CTO, for me, it's or for management at all, Python looks better with type hints, or because it's more like Java or more like stuff which is stronger and less prone to errors. So that's another feature that management will like if you tell them, okay, we use type hints. And as you will see, it's not really intrusive. You can still do your own things and benefit from type hints. And again, that's the rationale I talked about. This is provisional, and there's two PEPs, 484 and 411. So you can use it wherever you want and not use it wherever you don't want to use it. So it's really wherever you want, just add it. It makes your code better. And if you don't want or think it's inappropriate, don't use it. You'll see some examples where it's very difficult to use type hints, and you'll understand maybe better what I'm talking about. We have sometimes programs to analyze the code, like PyLint, PyFlakes, etc. We can automatically use it using testing frameworks to also test this kind of things, like PyTest is doing. But using annotations, it's part of the code and it's clearer. We make the work of these tools easier. And in Python 2, we'll use stub, and I'll show it maybe a little later. We also need stub files for C extensions for the stdlib, because we're not going to add type hints into all the stdlib. Maybe later on it will go, but this is a gradual typing. So every time, every now and then, there will be more and more documentation into the code and more type hints. But it will not happen in a day. So stub files may help there. Obviously, for legacy code that we don't want to change for various reasons, we can add stub files. It's like header files in C or in other languages that help us. And obviously for Python 2, because Python 2 does not support annotations. So we need it for Python 2. So the very simple thing is a function getting a string and returning a string. As you can see, the annotations are non-intrusive. This is very easy to understand. It's very Pythonic to see something like this and say, oh, I see, greetings as a first argument, which is a name, which I now understand it's also a string, and it returns a string. So very nice, very easy to understand. And this feature that enables us to do this kind of things is called annotations. This has been in Python 3 for a while now, but now, the annotations that are in this kind of format are called type hints, and we'll see the advantage of standardizing these annotations. We can still have some of our code without annotations, without type hints at all. So this is like an old code. IDE, or the static analyzers, can see that we call a function called greeting and know that the name expected to be a string. And if you call greet with something which is not a string, it can still tell you, hey, you're providing an integer into a function that eventually sends it into another function that expects a string. And PyCharm knows how to do that. That's great. So even if you only do partial annotations, partial type hinting, you still get a lot of advantage, and you still get noticed when your code is passing something which is not what the code expects, or whoever built the functions said, I expect only a string to be here at the argument. In order to do gradual typing, we need the annotated code to conform to the type hints. This means that there's a standard what type hints are, and we have to do the annotations as the standard defines. And if we don't provide any type hint, this means that we use something called any, which means basically anything. Whatever you put here is okay, because we didn't limit in any way. So greet is, as defined earlier, becomes name is actually anything, and it can return anything. And obviously, you can see that here in this case, we're calling another function. Any is like magic. Part of this presentation has mathematical aspects, and the mathematics behind classes typing and type hints. In order to do such an any, it has to be a subtype of everything and a supertype of anything, which means that that might have been a loop. In order to avoid that, they did a little magic, which it means it can still be a super of any other type. It can still be a derivative of any other type, but it cannot close a loop. Otherwise, anything would have been transitive. So. Maybe a better word would be is consistent with, and any means consistent with anything. That's here you can see more about gradual typing. The important thing is in subclassing, we want the superclass to be a valid input, and any subclass should be a valid input to where we expect a superclass, and vice versa, depending on what we do. So if we define a subclass as the expected input, we cannot take a generic superclass and put it in, because it may miss some of the features which are inside the subclass. But for the superclass, we can provide the subclass. In order to complete type hinting and enable a lot of things like the any, They added the typing.py module. This one is actually, except for this part, the PEP includes just definitions and explanations on how. And by using a module, no new syntax is required. The same old annotations, old in version 3, is doing all the job for us. And we can have it, it's backward compatible with anything starting in 3.2, which means we can use the type ints for any code from 3.2 and above. That's before the magic, but you see that classes are also valid hints. So if we have a function in class chart to set a label, so you can see I marked the types of the arguments. And obviously, set label returns a boolean, and the get nearest return a string, which might be the label for this nearest point or whatever, etc. And you can see that in make label, we have an argument which receives a chart, and then we have a label. I think they're talking for themselves, but you can see that typing provides us additional things like list and tuple, which are capital case. In order to be able to do in the annotations something that will tell us this is a list, in each item of the list should be a tuple, and the tuple actually have two float arguments. So this gives us a very detailed information about what we're doing, instead of just saying there's a list, okay, and any item in the list could be any. No, we have a more detailed information, which means that the type checker can do much, much better work. So if you want to iterate over some stuff, instead of just saying it's a list, it can be now any iterable, as long as it returns us a tuple with two floats, which again is a better presentation to what we look for. Okay, so that's explanation about the iterable. And when we want to see, we can return a class. And again, a class is a type. So wherever we put a type, in order to say this is of type int or string, we can put any class of our own. And now we'll see the any and union. So union, which means A should be either an int or a float or a string. So we allow any of these three, because they allow us to do the operation, or the addition operation. And a union, which says int or none, for example, which is an optional, this is something optional, we can write int or none, or just like that. PyCharm also accepts, whenever we put an int and initialize it for none, it accepts also the value none and understands that it's actually a union. And again, tuple enables us to say this tuple has two ints and then a string, or we can have a tuple with sequence of floats, whatever they are. So we allow floats, and there's the ellipses to signal that. We can mark something as callable. Again, all these names or all these IDs are actually from typing.py. So they are provided for you, and you just use them, and they are type ints. I want to emphasize, the code is running the same as before. When we run the code, the functions don't check the value that it's really int or anything like that. It just for our static analyzer, for our documentation, for this kind of reasons. And the code will run the same whether we put it or don't put it. It will run the same. So no change on the code, just to benefit us on the compiler side, on the type checking, on IDE, whatever we want. So there's a way to do generic types, do it yourself. You want your own type with something as generic, and then you can use something that said chart of some my own type, and then select the type. There's an example for strings, because in Python 3, as was mentioned in previous presentations, there's an issue with strings. There's bytes, and there's string, and there's a Unicode string, actually. So there's a union for them, which is called AnyString, and you can use it. This was an issue because node is not yet defined until the end of the class. So they figure out a way to do that by using a string in the annotation. That's the way when we want to refer something which is the same object as the object we are defining now, the way to do that in type ints is to use a string. So That's the way to do that. Just a word about the stub files. They're called PyI. So for example, foo.pyI is the stub for foo.py, and it can include all the definitions we want. And then we can work with typeints in Python 2 as well. It's much, much easier when it's part of our code, it's documenting, and here we have an additional work. I work with Python 3, so it's not an issue for me. But again, for those of you who use Python 2 and would like to have typeints, that's one way to do that. And then you have dummy classes methods, and you can also do overloading in the PyI files if for some reason there's different things to do. So you can do overloading using a decorator. There's sometimes we want to disable type checking for some reason. There's a way to do that. And there's a way to do type hinting for variables using a hash comment and say what the type is. Shortly about the history, it goes back amazingly to the 90s, where there were many kind of discussions about type hints and annotations. Started again in 2004. C0107, which defines function annotations, was 2006. And in the really last 2-3 years, Guido went forward and using conventions, they went into PEP 484, which is the PEP defining the type hints. Okay, these are some links related. Again, you'll have the presentation, so people who want to dive a little deeper are most welcome. Well, args is a list of obviously open, and quarks is a dictionary. Do type hints do with args and quarks? I didn't deal with it, really. I didn't ask myself. So I think the point is if you want to define them, you can define them as something, but I'm not sure type hints support that because it's a generic to enable anything, basically. So I guess the default is any. But I'm not sure about that. So the question was, how do type hints help us to document values provided by yield? So the way to do that is, I didn't give examples here, but for any variable, you can still have a comment and say type, colon, and the type of it. So if you know the variables, then once you get to the yield, you see what you yield, and that's by definition, if you want, it can be well typed. Because you say for each part of it what the type was, or for each variable you use inside, you can say this variable is a list of whatever. So you can still do that. Again, that's not yet part of the language like it's done here, but it does support that, and obviously the IDEs support it, and the static analyzers as well. So the question was, when we use type hints or don't use type hints, do we get the same bytecodes? And the answer is yes, we get the very same bytecodes. It helps the compiler in the sense that it's not help the compiler. The compiler understands this and knows to ignore this part. But it's not like it's doing a different code or optimizations. Although there are discussions whether in future versions, obviously 3.6 and maybe later on, to do this kind of thing. But the gradual typing philosophy says, let's have the community work with it for a while, understand what the requirements are, listen to the audiences, and then get back and decide what to do with that next. So thank you very much again.